Yeah, before we jump into the subject, I will just present myself, and then Christian will take over at some point, and he will present himself. So I'm Kasper, I'm a CTO and partner in Notes, and I've been doing mobile applications since Android 1.5. Actually, before that, I did Symbian apps as well at university. I'm one of those developers which came in fairly late. I think I wrote my first line of Java at the university, so I'm not one of those guys which had a father which taught them development when they were 10. But yeah, ever since I really enjoyed development and especially the mobile part of it. In 2011, I joined a company called Notes, and I was the first Android developer there, and we started picking up mobile apps really fast. At that point, the company only did Facebook applications, small web apps, stuff like that. So I started with Android, and then I moved more into the backend. Unfortunately, that was PHP, so I did a lot of Cake PHP and Laravel, Lumen kind of applications. And then lately, it's been more like Swift and Weber. I'm still doing quite a lot of development, even though I'm a CTO in a company, and like you can see my GitHub contribution, so I'm still really active on a lot of open source projects and, of course, client projects. But before we go further on, I just want to give a short introduction to Notes, and you have your notifications on. Yeah. So Notes is a digital agency. It's born out of Copenhagen, where we have our headquarters today. And today we primarily build mobile applications with backends, of course. Last year we actually got acquired by a Japanese company, and that gave us some power to move more out in Europe. So now you can see we are in two cities in Denmark and two cities in UK. Amsterdam, Berlin, and Prague is all new offices from this year. And we are, I think, almost 100 employees now across the offices. So yeah, we do a lot of mobile applications, and I think this is a screenshot from our GitHub repository, and you can see Swift is the top language across all our repository, and that's, of course, because we also adopted Swift on the server side, and I will get into that. The kind of projects we are hired into is like making like the UX design and the development maintenance for various clients across Europe. Some of the projects the client will handle the backend himself. Some of the projects we build everything. Classic agency in that sense. Yes, Christian.
Yeah, and that's basically me. So I'm Christian. I'm technical director of Notes in Berlin. I'm developing for almost 20 years now. Started out with funny things like Visual Basic and Turbo Pascal and Delphi before I went into web programming, PHP and so on, and found myself doing iOS in 2008 during my studies, which was really great, and I never left it actually. After that I actually I developed like 7-8 years in an agency. Like 50 different applications, a lot of applications that would connect to other products via Bluetooth and give you enhanced experiences. We did, for example, apps for Kettler, the training bikes. We did some apps for connecting a toothbrush, enhancing car experiences. Before I decided, I think you can see it here in the chart, when that happened, to join Notes. In May this year, one of the reasons was obviously that I wanted to code more again, and also I wanted to do more open source, which was not possible in my previous company. And with Notes, it gave me a really good chance here to open up a branch with my managing director here in Berlin. And now we have like a startup experience here in Berlin, but it's well-funded, I would say, with all the power from Notes and Monster Lab. So who we are? I make it short. We have this really nice, beautiful office in Berlin, which is really awesome. It's not really not only nice to work here, but it's also really good for the spirit of Notes, because we are not only doing apps, but we are also trying to spread the word about Vapor, server-side Swift, and so on. So we are also hosting a lot of events, and people enjoy coming to locations like these. And then we have nice speakers talking about digital innovation. Or we co-watched together the Apple keynote 3 days ago. in our nice little cinema that we have. And yeah, what you see here is like the team as it is right now. We are really, I would say, in the beginning right now. We have four people here. We have Martin, the managing director, myself. We have our awesome Vapor developer and organizer of this conference as well, Martin, and Nora, who is somewhere here, exactly, and doing a lot of the marketing stuff for us. Our plan is definitely to grow big, and we have a couple of new hires coming this year, but we are obviously always looking for iOS Vapor developers, so if you by any chance know any, let me know. And yeah, let's continue with Vapor at Nodes and how that all started, actually.
Cool. Yes, so I started as a mobile developer, as I said, and I took over the mobile department in Nodes fairly fast. But in 2012, I had the option to take on the entire development team in the company, so where I became CTO. At the same time, that was when we did PHP and CakePHP in 2012-13. But the kind of projects we took in, they got bigger and bigger, as you can see here, but we also maintained them for longer and longer. So for me, it was like I didn't really like what I saw with PHP and the way it worked for us in maintaining projects and working together, a lot of developers together. So you can see during the years, it got more and more annoying for us. We did a change from CakePHP, which is really like arrays everywhere, and then more into Laravel, which were more object oriented, but still with PHP. And then in 2015-16, I began scouting for like new options here for our backend team to dig into something new. So some of the requirements we had, it needs to be a really beautiful language, compile time, strictly typed. There needs to be some kind of modern MVC or M. Open source with a great community, running in Linux technologies. Ideally, you would like some good synergy with some of the other teams. The ones of you who work in agencies, you know how it is. It's all about having like high billables. People need to be in projects all the time. If they are benched, that's why you stop earning money, and the margins are actually not that big. So, like a developer not on a project for a month or two, then you lost the full year of revenue on them. So that was something we looked into as well. We could like utilize some of the skills we had in house. And the two biggest teams we have right now is iOS and Android natively, so that was definitely a big thing. And also, we want to move into something more performant than PHP. And of course, the last one is like, as an agency, you're never better than the talent you can attract. That's the only thing you actually sell. That's man hours, and the better they are, the easier it is to get higher rates and have happier clients. So, very important thing for us. And of course, it should fit the clients and projects we aim to get. So we did the full scouting, like of course PHP, Laravel, Symfony, that was the natural one. We were already there. We had a feeling with that it was more for like startup projects, like in the beginning was not so enterprise. The same way we had a hard time attracting really good backend developers in PHP. There's a lot of them out there doing WordPress, small applications, etc. But like big scale projects, that was more or less impossible or very hard to find. We looked, of course, at Ruby on Rails, very mature, but we also felt that it was on the way down. Node was still like in its spike up, but we didn't really like the JavaScript part of it. We looked into Java, Spring Boot, but we had the same experience back then that we didn't feel Java was moving ahead. I think like if I had the decision again today, I would look more into this, but with a Kotlin extension on Java. C#, I personally like the language a lot, but it didn't really fit into our requirements of going with a Linux stack. Python, a good option as well, but for attracting talent for web development, it was not as easy. There's a lot of the Python developers out there, but it's more like math, AI stuff. And then, of course, the last one was Go language, where we liked what we saw, but we didn't see a mature or like a nice web framework which like came with everything. So we ended up with looking at Swift and Vapor, and that's where we still are today. So some of the pros was we really liked what we saw with the language, of course. Everyone have been mentioning this today, so let's skip those. High quality source code. We read some of the things they did early on and liked what we saw. We would get some synergy with the iOS team, and that was, of course, a big pro for us. The community already back then was really good. They had a Slack channel with like 500, 600 people already before even 1.0. Was Linux, fast performance, and of course powered by Apple, so it was not some kind of, it was not a small open source project where you could be afraid someone just abandoned it overnight. And of course, the big con was that this is a very young framework and unmature still in its stage. But we moved ahead and went all in. So kind of the journey was February 2016. I wrote Tanner at Slack and invited him to come to Copenhagen to meet me and some of the other partners. In March, yeah, already in May, we set up a company together with Tanner and Logan and they quit the job and went all in Weber at that point. Rest of 2016, we allocated a resource to just start picking up on the framework, making sure that we had all the tools we needed to build a project that was a decent database connection, that we could have a Redis, that all these kind of things, S3 integrations, stuff like that. And then actually in January 2017, that was the same month, Stefan started in Notes. We started our first project, and at that point it was a bit scary just to jump in, but it ended up pretty well. I think Stefan had some long evenings to get everything running in the end, but the project is still live today, and the client is happy about it. And what we are at the moment is we have done more than 25 projects in Weber at this point. We have been doing a lot of open source projects as well, as people have been mentioning these days, that there's still a lot of packages missing to Swift at this point. So for us, it's about filling out those gaps as well when we have time. And we now have eight Weber developers on the team, and half of them can like switch into iOS development. And that's a really strong position to be in as an agency. Gives a lot of flexibility. Yeah, so this is from GitHub yesterday. 57 Weber repositories, so you can see we have quite a lot of projects ongoing. This is some of the clients we've been working for, and it's not just small startup clients, that's of course some of them, but it's also fairly big clients like British American Tobacco or Master. Stark Man is a project just started. So we managed to convince rather big clients on going ahead with this. Yeah, here's our open source, our GitHub organization. Yeah, I think you should check it out if you haven't been in there. We have a lot of good packages out there, and I think personally, I think like the admin panel packages on one of them, I'm fairly proud about that. Most of you know if you need to have a API up running, there might be some content, or there might be like the client might want to come in somewhere and see a list of users, be able to disable them, etc. So that's like a backend interface just with Weber and Leaf, super simple to get going with, and then you'll be able to like modify your data without having database access. But also, yeah, JWT started from Siemens and got now adopted into Weber, and we have a Bugsnag as well. I think it's been so people mentioned that that it's missing some kind of like tool to send errors from production. So we have a package for that as well. And the last thing was like, so the recruitment part, I think someone also mentioned it already, but for us it's really been a really strong thing. Like we managed to get developers from all over the world contacting a small mobile agency in Copenhagen to work for us. So we have a couple of people coming from US and like Germany and Amsterdam. And before we had Weber in our stack, that was impossible. If you had to get those kind of talents into the company, you had to pay really high. And so for us, this has been a really good thing. Like the whole open source, a lot of blog posts, and also getting the right people in to take on this adventure, because it is not as easy as just picking Ruby, at least it was not in the beginning. So some of the learnings.
So, of course, we had some of the learnings after we switched to Vapor. Some positive learnings, some rather negatively touched, I would say. What was definitely positive is that Swift is a really rich language, so you get a lot of the features for what you need frameworks in other languages for free. We discovered that we need way less unit testing. That's clear because it's so strict and type safe. So we could really focus on testing our business logic, the models, and so on, instead of doing all this boilerplate testing. Availability of threading allowed us to simplify our infrastructure. So most of you probably know, when you have some PHP background, that threading is not so easy / impossible. So you would need to offload your work to other workers, and we can just skip that now. Hosting costs. I mean, that's also clear. If you have something that has a very low memory footprint, low CPU usage, and so on, then it's probably also not so expensive to run it on a cloud system. PHP extensions are not there, and we are happy for that. Synergy between iOS and Vapor is quite good, I would say. I mean, there's always things you could wish that could work differently or better, or could be better integrated. But yeah, we have a lot of developers that can do both, and now we can work together on problems and solve them and share some code. That's really great. Less bugs, obviously, due to the nature that we get all the feedback, or most of the feedback, during compile time. And yeah, some, let's say, drawbacks or things that are not working perfectly right now. Foundation is not fully supported on Linux right now, so there are a lot of implementations are not implemented yet. Yeah, but I recommend to check out this bookmark. It always has a status about what's supported, what not. Also, it's a good reason, it's actually a good idea to set up CI and make sure that whatever you build is always automatically built on Linux as well. Because if you worked on something and you immediately see that something is crashing, it's really easy for you to find the issue. But if you just test it 3 months later when you go live, then you might be lost a bit. Missing libraries was a topic in the past days, I guess. Though there are still some libraries we would like to have, actually, for Vapor, server-side Swift, and so on. The lack of package management for iOS, but maybe we can have a look into Helge's solution here. And yeah, let's sum it up, right?
Yeah, so for like, I think that's a question I've been asked most today. How do you manage to get your clients to accept or go for server side stack in Swift? And like, so the classic arguments there is for like a CTO or a client or a technical director in the client's company is these. So for example, like, they have a legacy code base, some old code running in Java or something, and they want to keep that stack and just not look at anything else. Maybe they have a C# team or a Python team or a team already, and that's the direction they want to take. And that's, of course, some of the harder like arguments. But some of the things I've also been seeing is like, maybe that CTO, he just read a couple of blog posts about Node.js or Mean Stack is super awesome. Never really tried it. Maybe been to a conference, or he, like, had some friends telling him about it. And in that situation, it's fairly easy to take a conversation with them and try to convince them, but also like argue what's the pros and cons are for these things. Because very often they're not super into the details here, so you can win these arguments. Cost savings, so that's some of the things we hear all the times, and like, we push really hard for native mobile applications, because we've done quite a lot of hybrid applications during the years, and like, we never saved any money for any clients trying to do hybrid, if they want the same quality at least. So we push already for that, and then like, that means for most of the old, more legacy companies where they it's already two new languages they have to accept on their stack. It's Kotlin and Swift. So if you also want to introduce like Node.js, or you want to introduce Golang, then it's three languages. So the cell there on saying, okay, then there's only two languages you have to accept. That actually works quite often. Then you can look into like weaknesses, problems in the current stack and see if there's a solution. So like dig in somewhere and take that argument.
I think it's also important that you really listen to your client and that you not only go there and say, our stack is so awesome, please take it. It's really important that you try to understand where they're coming from, because only then you can really convince them. We also collected some good reasons why you should actually go with server-side Swift. One obvious one is synergy with iOS, as we said. It could be better, but you already have code sharing if you want. You can solve the same problems with two teams. And if you do an iOS app and backend in parallel, it helps a lot.
Yeah, so the same point here again with the Swift team. So if you already have a Swift team, why not utilize them? I think we've been through that point, but it's very clear, of course.
Then you have less bugs in production. That's more like a summary. We heard it a lot in the past.
Super fast. So this one as well scales, but also for team size. So I guess for those of you who've been in PHP, if you go five PHP developers in the same code base, you're going to be doing a lot of mess for each other all the time, unless you do really high code cough of your unit test. And with a compiled language, it's just a lot easier to collaborate. If someone starts refactoring, it will break everywhere where they change something, which of course to all of you is super simple. But for people in PHP, this is a big step forward.
Then the low memory footprint is clear. We told it already. Then I think I cannot stress this enough. Swift is already. Or Swift-powered apps are already running on so many devices in the wild, so I think that's also a good argument, and also why they're not necessarily server-side Swift apps that are run there. It's clear that this programming language already is very mature. And we have Apple pushing the language, IBM is pushing the language. I think it also helps that what we heard in the morning, that companies like ING DiBa, that they now jump on the server-side Swift train. We have Apple pushing the language with Apple Playgrounds, with all their education programs. So it's just a matter of time before we have a new generation of Swift developers.
Yeah, so microservice architecture, that's really something which is coming at the moment. And I think there's been three, four talks about it this conference. And with Swift, it really makes sense again, because it's super, super fast and easy to get set up, and you can keep it really small. You don't have to get a big Ruby on Rails project set up and slowing everything down.
Exactly. Then it also might help to find the right contact. That sounds like no-brainer, but just check your networks. Sometimes you have the contact that is working as an engineer in the company that you're just pitching for and that can support you to pitch from inside for the same technology stack, give you some insights. And yeah, start small, grow big. Most of the big companies, they have IT departments which are only effective if you run projects of a specific size. So maybe it makes sense to start small with Vapor and establish some lighthouse projects there.
So I think even our like Japanese company, Monster Lab in Tokyo, they managed to get their first Vapor project as well now. We spend a lot of time with them on how to convince the client as well on that. And they managed to do that as well now and had hired their first Vapor developer full-time. And lately I've been working on a project out of Dubai, and they have it's a massive company, like Uber competitor of the Middle East, and they had a big like security team, and that security team kind of actually said like PHP as a language, we don't want to touch that in the future, like get rid of that. So I asked them what kind of language they were actually open for, and Swift was on the list there now. So that's also very cool to see. So even the security guys, they're behind this as well. So just, I think the point is trying to figure out who you can get with you slowly, and then build up the arguments. Yeah, and then I think, when all this started 2.5 years ago, was I wouldn't have dreamt of that we had a conference like this already at this point. So I would just thank the guys behind the conference a lot, and let's give them a big hand.